Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Talk with the Titans, live from London, UK, all the way to the US of A and worldwide. I'm your host, Callum L, and this is Talk with the Titans. On tonight's show, we've got our brother, our acting grand sheik himself, brother Sharif Bey in the building. Islam, Islam to you, Mo.
Islam, brother man. Islam to all the listeners and the viewers.
Excellent, excellent. And I know you're coming back literally triumphant from your victory off or after the debate, the debate with you and Reggie. You have to let us know, man, how was that? How was the feeling to be in the National Black Theater where there is hundreds of people just queued up for you, literally just to see you speak?
It was, oh my goodness, it was amazing, but it was amazing for a number of reasons. The National Black Theater and the events of the House of Conscience, other events there, have never seen that many Moorish Americans in one place, ever. And you know, our people, you know, people in general, if they don't see it, it doesn't exist. So for the audience that was there that were not Moorish Americans, that was very, very shocking, because they've never seen such a congregation of Moorish Americans, so it's almost as if they don't believe it exists, at least in New York City. So to see 100-plus Moorish Americans, red fezes and turbans, in the building was incredible. Not just incredible, we'll see that later, but for the others that were there, for, you know, with the House of Consciousness, with the RBG community, the Kemetic Nile Valley community, I can't even imagine what they were thinking, because they've never seen it before.
That's right. It was literally seeing a sea of sharp-suited brothers all wearing fezes. You know, it was eye-opening, to say the least. Definitely. And you know what? I actually came down, for the polite debate as well, and I saw, you know, that's actually a beautiful thing as well to see, because, you know, we don't really get to see it much with inside of the Kemetic community, whereas the Moorish community definitely has or seems to have like a community of Moors all dressed in uniform, all representing one thing, and just huddled together like it's just how can I call it, a vanguard. You know, when I saw them all surrounding you at that day of the debate, I was like, okay, this is impressive. We can take a Kemetic community, and other communities can take a definite a page out of the Moorish book for that.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Let me speak to that really quick. You know, there's, again, dealing with the whole visual thing. This is very important. You know, it's subtle but yet powerful. When you see a group of men or women that are dressed alike, the presumption is that you're looking at one big body, one singular mind. And there's a power to that. And all it takes is a couple seconds. You see that group together. That's why uniforms are so important. That's why uniforms are so attractive to people, because you see that they belong to something bigger than what you physically see. That's the spiritual power of community. You know what I mean? You know, when you look alike, you think and act alike, and there's a greater power to that. You know what I mean? And that's what people see.
Definitely, definitely. And you know what? You have to, come on, we're here now. You need to give us a recap of the debate. Let us know, let the community know, for those who haven't actually seen the debate itself, let everybody know how it went down.
Yes, sir. Well, I tell you, this is going to be the first, a lot of what I'm going to say is going to be a first in the public, coming from us, and just period. So, and I'm going to, very candid. You know, I'm going to be very candid. I'm not going to be so PC. You know, I'm going to give everybody, the what we would say, the truth and the divine truth. So, the debate itself that day was interesting. If you were paying attention or listening, at least 30% of my presentation wasn't so much addressing scholarship or addressing scholarship in general. It was addressing psychology, like one of the first things I led off with after Brother Reggie, shout out to Brother Reggie, after I left, or after Brother Reggie finished and I started, one of the first things I pointed out about his presentation that was very detailed, it just wasn't on topic. And it wasn't on topic because of something that we all knew, my brothers and Ali's men knew already, is that most people, this is one of the issues with the Moorish movement or in the Moorish movement, that when we speak about nationality, our people are so far removed from the knowledge of nationality and national identity that it takes a certain measure of education or re-education to even be able to have an intelligent conversation on the topic. So we knew because the brother for months and months and months prior was doing video after video after video after video, just listening to him, we were like, wow, he doesn't understand what nationality is. So we already knew that was going to be an issue in our favor. He was going to start talking about genetics. He was going to start talking about phenotypes. He would talk about, because this is what almost everybody nationality. They compare apples to oranges. And so we're not talking about genetics. We're not talking about race. We're not talking about phenotype. We're talking about national identity. So when you don't know the topic, you're really not in the room. You know what I mean? So we're addressing a lot of erroneous thinking. Like later on during the Q&A, our brother Shaka Utmost, shout out to Shaka Utmost, when he said I was disingenuous, he accused me of being disingenuous about a source that I had cited regarding the study of color in Egypt. And the first thing I said is that, well, you can't call me, you can't make a judgment call on my character because I present a source. If you want to critique the source, then have at it, critique the source. I said, but what I would offer is that what we're doing is we're looking at the same source from two different viewpoints. The viewpoint you're looking at it from is the viewpoint that the ancient Egyptians painted these characters based on ethnicity or race. The viewpoint that the source is going by is that they painted these issues or they painted these characters based upon symbolism, color symbolism. And so he went back to the argument, oh, well, it's racial and you're taking your side. So I reiterated and then gave him an example. If you only want to be just, you condemn yourself. If they painted Osiris as black because he had black skin, when did it change to green? Because he's also painted as green. So now you're tasked with deciding when they were talking about ethnicity and when they were talking about skin. And that ended the conversation. So it wasn't even so much as the scholarship we were addressing. We were addressing the way of thinking about it.
All right. And for everybody who is tuned in right now, I'm going to implore you to please hit the share button, because this is, well, you already know, it's getting interesting, it is interesting, and I can't wait, because it's going to get fired up real shortly. So please, everybody who's watching right now, this is a Titans TV Talk with the Titans exclusive. Please hit the share button down below. Share on your Facebook, your socials, your Twitter, your Instagram, your Google, everywhere you possibly can. Please hit the share button. I know we've started a tiny bit late, but just hit the share button. Everybody know that we're here. We're live right now in the building. It's about to go down. Our brother Sharif Bey is giving us an exclusive, a first-hand eyewitness into the debate, the intricacies of the debate itself, as well as behind the scenes access of things that I'm pretty sure most of us out here didn't know that what that was going on, basically. So you know what, let's get it in, Sharif. I'm gonna allow you to continue again, unless you want me to ask you a question, because I've got some real questions I need to ask you. I'm gonna okay. Go on, continue.
Let me jump. I want to jump right into what you just said about some of the behind the scenes thing. And again, I'm going to be very candid, and this is the truth and the divine truth. You know, it's not, meaning to be condescending or meaning to be negative. We're just telling the truth. Okay. We knew from the door that we were walking into a trap. I'm talking about Ali's men and this whole thing. We knew we were walking into a trap. What I mean by trap is we knew we were walking into a fixed situation. It was a fixed situation. And here's one example. We started Sinetta and House of Consciousness, and Brother Reggie approached me, or we had our first conversation about the terms or whether I was going to accept the challenge. Let me make that clear, too. These brothers challenged me. The Moors and the Moorish Americans and the Moor Science Symbol of America do not engage in debates. We don't do that type of thing. You know, we took this on after a long time of consideration, and the purpose we took it on for was not to debate Reggie or to engage in adversarial conversation, bless you, brother. But it was to, for the first time in this community, present a logical, concise, sober, and responsible view of the Moorish movement as taught by Prophet Noble Drew Ali. That was the purpose. Win, lose, draw, we didn't care. We just wanted to present. Now, of course, it's a debate, so we're going to come wearing the proper jersey. You know, we're not going to come to a debate and not debate. But the intent was really to teach, not to be adversarial. That being said, since September of 2015, we've been negotiating. We fought over these terms because House of Consciousness and Brother Reggie changed the terms at least three times, changed the topics at least three times. And if you remember in the beginning of my first round, I mentioned one of the topics that they changed. The first thing was that they were adamant on, they called it a debate, but they were adamant on making it one-sided, just like previous debates against the Moors. The celebrated debate between Seti and Alim Bey, right? Sawasut and Seti and Alim Bey. The title was Dismantling the False Teachings of Noble Drew Ali and the Moorish Science Symbol of America. How in the world is that bilateral or equal consideration? How in the world could somebody like Sawasut and Seti lose when he had nothing to lose? You see what I'm saying? If you remember watching that video, I was there at that debate. I asked two questions. I asked Sinetta if he would allow me to ask two questions. I asked Sawasut and Seti, I said, what is the title of this debate? He said, Dismantling the Teachings of Noble Drew Ali in the Moorish Science Temple. I said, okay. Brother Alim, are you an official or a member of the Moorish Science Temple of America? That's all I had to say. And of course, you know, there was grumbling and then there was mumbling, and then I walked away, but it was to prove a point. The point was, you're not debating an official representative or even a member of the organization, so this really isn't a debate. But now, that debate, if you remember, was one of the first big debates on House of Consciousness. It did two things. One, it really helped to push the whole debate culture within that community and help grow it and develop it. Two, it set a view or a stigma on the Moorish community that if you need a win in the debate community, all you got to do is challenge the Moors. They're an easy win. That's what that did. And that's gone on for like 7 years up until this past week.
And now we've entered into the golden age of the Moors.
That's right. So let's continue, bro. So, like I said, the terms had changed. The terms of the debate and the topics had changed numerous times. And the thing I insisted on is equal consideration. If you're going to challenge us, if you're going to take shots at us, we get to take an equal amount of shots at you. We're not going to we're showing intelligence here now. We're not camera prostitutes where we just want to be in front of the camera and get some money. That's not us. We don't care about all of that. You see, what we care about is making sure that the people out there in the public understand where what the Moorish movement is about, what the Teachings of Noble Drew Ali is about. That's it. So, like I said, the topics changed a couple times. And they kept the struggle was for them to have less to answer to and us to have more to answer to. This took place right on up until 3:35 a.m. the morning of the debate. Shout out to Brother Divine Prospect. He was the moderator. Shout out to that brother. He has integrity. I respect him. Okay. That being said, myself, Brother Reggie, and I had to email him bios for him to read about us. At 3:35 a.m., I woke up. My phone beeped. I got an email from Divine Prospect for the with the debate format. I opened it up and looked at it. The first thing, it had Brother Reggie listed as prosecutor and me as defendant. I'm like, oh, that's not going to do. The whole entire first round was him interrogating me about Moorish American identity. That's definitely not going to work. So I contacted the moderator and said, we can't accept that. I gave him a few small revisions. Take the defendant and prosecution thing out of there. I said, and if I got to defend being Moorish American or Moorish American identity, he's got to defend black identity because that's what he stands on. So Divine Prospect said, yes, you're correct. I'll make the proper revisions. He did. He said, I'm going to send them to Brother Reggie. I stayed up. I didn't want to go back to sleep. So every hour or so, I checked in with the brother and I said, brother, what did Reggie say? He says, I haven't heard from him. I haven't heard from him. He's went on for hours. We went to our Sunday school meeting. Still haven't heard. We made it to the venue. Still nothing. So we're in the back room, and this is on the early live stream, when we're in the back room going over the format. At one particular point, talking about round two, Divine Prospect looks at me, says, is that all right? You all are to present your plans and implementation. Explain implementation. I said, that's okay for you? I said, yes. He asked Brother Reggie, is that okay for you? Brother Reggie said, well, brother, I thought I was only going to be questioning him about his plan, and I wouldn't have to talk about mine. Divine Prospect said, no, sir, did you get the email and look at the format? He goes, oh, no, I didn't. We know why now. The reason we know is because the brother Divine Prospect told me at the end of the night, told me at the end of the night that he got the original debate format along with Reggie's bio sent from Reggie and Sarnetta. So, of course, the rhetorical question is, what in the world is the host and the promoter and the adversary doing presenting a debate format to the moderator? The moderator asked them, has Brother Sharif seen this? And they said, no, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. So the whole thing they thought was fixed right up until the moment of the debate. They thought it was fixed.
Wow, wow, wow. Wow. Yeah,
that's how that happened. Okay, now let me fast forward. First round, after the first round, there were interviews. And this was interesting because... shout out to the elder, Professor James Smalls, who they brought. Shout out to Dr. Leonard Jeffries, who was in the building as well. Both these individuals stated, Brother Sharif, at the end of the debate, they said, Brother Sharif, you didn't have one debate, you had three debates. Because during the intermission, and basically tried to debate me in the interview. During the question and answer, Brother Shaka Upmost tried to debate me during the question and answer. He said, so it wasn't Brother Reggie versus all Moors, as he said it in one of his interviews before the debate. It was Brother Sharif and Anayil Bey versus House of Consciousness, because that's how it went down in the debate. Mm-hmm. So, and then is the key, the kicker. During the Q&A, Brother Red Pill, shout out to Red Pill, Blue Pill, Noble Edge. Shout out to those brothers, good brothers. He asked me a question. He asked really both of us a question, but he asked me in particular first. He says, what do we do now going forward in terms of working together, functional unity? What do we do now going forward? What are you going to do to work with everybody, bring together? I said, well, brother, I already presented the plan that we already have on the ground running in my second round. That plan, just like what Noble Drew Ali did in 1928, wasn't just for fez-wearing, turban-wearing, Moorish American, card-carrying Moorish Americans, members of the Moorish side of Civil America. That plan benefited all of our people in that area. That's what it did. I said, we're doing the same thing in Syracuse, New York, and in a couple of other cities, duplicating the effort. It is for all of us. It benefits all of us. I said, we will come on our own dime to New York City and help you organize and mobilize. We will go door to door and show you how to do it. We will do it and carry you through it ourselves on our own dime. When I said that, there was a brother in the back with the RBG community that stood up and said, listen, brother, can you give us your email address so we can send you our emails so we can get this pop? And as I began to respond was when Sarnetta took the microphone from the moderator and began to agitate. He walked over to where the majority of the Moorish Americans were sitting and began to agitate them and say, no, y'all, you know, and brought up an issue that was already resolved. And it was, and truthfully, is a non-issue. Because we're now talking about functional unity that's going to benefit and improve the life conditions and the condition of living for our people. And he wants to revert back to a photo op, a so-called unity picture that Moors didn't show up to a picture, a photo shoot, and then agitate until he got one of our people. Now, we had 100-plus people in the room. Until he got one, finally got one, to come out of character. Our Muftis escorted that one immediately to the back, and he didn't stop. He kept going, and that's when we saw this pandemonium. We quickly got it under wraps, but think about it. We had 100-plus people in the room. We had a security force of 15-plus, trained, disciplined, focused, and capable. You already know the rest of the story. You see? That was, and I'm here on camera to say it, I'm here on the show to say it, that was extremely reckless, extremely disingenuous, extremely dangerous. And I will go on record to say that what Sarnetta did, what House of Consciousness did at that moment, was a 2016 rendition of the Audubon Ballroom. Only thing different is that we got the vibration under control before the blood hit the floor. And that's just the truth. That was reckless. That brother's wife and that brother's son were in the building. That was reckless. And I'm not done yet. A number of hours later, I checked my phone. The brother Sarnetta had called me like about four times, sent me a number of text messages, called my other brother, an elder brother, Raleem Salahuddin Il, and left a message with him. The message he left with him was, I started that stunt on purpose because I was upset. What he said to me, I will read right now, right off my phone. Give me a second. Right off the phone. Here we go. First message, come on, man, pick up the phone. Second message. Let me say first that I apologize to you. Tomorrow I have to do a live stream and talk to the people about who I think won. And it's kind of hard for me, but I have to tell the truth. You won hands down. I will make the announcement 2 p.m. live. We already know that it wasn't at 2 p.m. It was maybe a few hours later. But that's what happened.
Wow. Literally, the plot thickens. I don't even know what to say right now. I'm just hearing shock and awe. That's what.
That's what happened, brother. Mm-hmm. Now, I will say this rhetorical, but I will say this. If you had so much confidence in your brother, and if you had so much confidence in your view, why would you need to go through all of that? You know what I mean? What was the purpose? What was the purpose of all of that? Oh, another thing too. See, we're all security minded. I mean, I teach martial arts and teach security as a profession. That's what I do. So if we're to come into a brotherly, it may be adversarial in terms of education or in terms of a discourse, but it's a debate. It's not a shootout. It's not a shootout or a fist fight. Why in the world would you show up with a bulletproof vest on? Brother Reggie was there with a bulletproof vest on. What in the world are you showing up? Unless, one, you're just trying to conflate a situation or give the impression that it's something that it's not, which does a number of things. It justifies anything you or your comrades might do. Or two, possibly, you knew things may get to a point where that vest might be needed and functional. Once again, you got women and children in the building. This is supposed to be House of Consciousness. Go ahead, brother. It looks like you want to say something.
Yeah, you know, what you're saying to me is like they were attempting to escalate the situation where things actually, you know, caught on to be violent. Is that what you're actually saying?
I'm saying that, well, I'll tell you exactly what I'm saying. I won't say that they were planning for things to get crazy. I will say that they were willing by demonstration, by the brothers' actions, they were willing chaos and anarchy. They were willing to risk that to maintain control of their audience. And what I mean by control is I mean ideological and monetary. Because the moment where we say, hey, we can work together, and even their audience says, we'll work with you, that means he lost his purse. That means he lost the bag. Because it calls into question, well, are you really for unity? Are you really for unity? And how do you define unity? Do you define it with a photo op? We take pictures? How do you define unity? Getting a bunch of people to put their fists in the air and say black power? Is that unity? Like, come on. Stop. No, stop. You make an issue to the point where blood is almost spilled because you got a group of people that won't put their fists in the air and say black power for you, man. Stop. You know? So that's what we're saying. What that was reckless and irresponsible. Reckless and irresponsible.
And there was a point in the night, you know, I've seen a video where there was a point in the night where, you know what, a bunch of Moors had, you know, Sarneta surrounded. Well, so the video claimed. I didn't actually get to see him surrounded, but the video, you know, proposed to say that Sarneta was surrounded by a bunch of Moors. Could you speak on that issue there?
Absolutely. Again, you know, Moors are, you know, the Moorish Americans. Let me just say this: a lot of people, and I'm talking about ourselves too. This goes back to what I said before about seeing so many Moors and being in the presence of so many Moors in one place. That had an effect on us as Moorish Americans. It really did. In a very positive and uplifting and almost euphoric, right? The effect it had on those in the community is this. It's one thing to talk about unity. It's another thing to see it displayed right in front of you. That was altogether different. That was altogether different. So if one of us thinks a particular way or moves a particular way, we all do. Now, our brother Sarneta was not in danger. He was not in danger. We made sure of it. That's what you were looking at. But at the same time, you know, they needed to see a show of strength. Because prior to that, it's like we don't respect these people. And see, in the street, we talk about this, all you have is respect. Because if I don't respect you, and let's just be real, if I don't respect you, I'd make you easier to kill. Because to not respect another human being that's just like you is to dehumanize them. And to dehumanize another human being is to make them easy to kill. We had 7 years of House of Consciousness dehumanizing Moorish Americans. We had 7 years of it. You see what I'm saying? When I can dehumanize you, I put you in danger. And not just you, but anybody else that thinks the way you do. They needed to see what our prophet said. Prophet Noble Dra Ali said, Moors are men, upright, independent, and fearless, who care for their loved ones and follow their prophet to a destiny that's neither uncertain nor unknown. They needed to see that. So our brother Sarneta wasn't in danger. But I will go so far as to say, if we wanted him to be in danger, you know the rest of the story.
All right. You know what? For everybody who's tuned in right now and you're loving the information that you're hearing so far, please give us a big thumbs up. Let us know that we're doing a great job as well. You know, leave your comments in the comment section as well. I would love to have some interaction with you as well. Shout-outs to everybody who's tuned in right now. Give a shout-out to Mark G. A shout-out to Front Streets Life. Shout-outs to Robin White as well. And, of course, Moabit as well. Come on. I see you, my people. Truth Hurts as well. Shalom, shalom. So you know what? Before I actually go into that, for everybody who is new as well and is just tuning in, just live, fresh, new, and don't know much about Talk with the Titans, Talk with the Titans was literally birthed out of the idea that the intellectual giants, the titans of our community, should have a well-organized platform to present, discuss, and debate critical information affecting our community, proposed by you, our audience, our community. So literally, if you would like any topics to be addressed on this show, please leave it down below in the comment section, and I'm sure to read it, I'm sure to respond back to you, and I'm sure to make that happen. So please keep on the interaction. Let me know. Give a big shout-out to you. Salute. I see everybody in the comment section. I'm loving it. So let's get back into this. So we had brother Ishmael Bey. Ishmael Bey was on our show, you know, not too long ago, really rattling brother Reggie's cage, you know, really getting him out of character, really. You know, it was a great thing to view. Not in the sense that we want to see Brother Reggie rattled, but it's to just give us an insight of how this debate was, you know, or will turn out to be. So I want to know, was Brother Reggie in his fiery mode, or was he toned down for the debate? Because a lot of us may not have seen it, may not have catched the debate, may not have seen the information that was presented. So I would like for you to speak on Brother Reggie and, you know, his mode of conduct at the debate, as well as the information he presented.
Sure. His demeanor and his disposition, he definitely was in, I guess, to the best of his ability, you know, turn-up mode. So, you know, at the debate. He was in, but it worked against him. And I'm going to tell you why it worked against him. It was in the way in which he wielded it was indicative of someone who, in addition to not being accustomed to being that kind of guy, also has some other issues as well. He became, on a number of occasions, he became confrontational with the audience. On a number of occasions, he actually antagonized the audience. Now, we're talking about a debate where there are no judges, except the audience being the judge. That is a very bad thing to do. You don't antagonize the judge. You don't antagonize the very people that are going to be deciding whether you won or lost. You know? And if you got a heckler out there, you got to know how to deal with that. You have to know how to deal with that. The last thing you do is someone would comment in the audience, that you turn and address that individual and engage them adversarially. You're not debating that individual. You know? So, you know, there's a measure of, I guess, for lack of a better way, you know, crowd decorum, or how to, or the proper handling of people. That's what it is that he lacks. And so that's something to work on. As far as the information, it's like what I mentioned before. I assume, I mean, some of it I'm familiar with. You know, actually a decent amount of what he presented in the first round I'm familiar with. It just was off topic. It was grossly off topic. And a number of individuals think maybe he was on topic, but that's only because they're ignorant to what nationality is as well. So if you're talking about Neanderthals and Denisovans and Cro-Magnon men, and you know their migrations out of the root of civilization, you're way off topic. More, quote unquote, is not a race. Never was. We never said it was. You know, in our questionnaire that we give to our children, the question is, what is his, talking about Noble Drelli, what is his nationality? The answer is Moorish American. What is your nationality? Moorish American. Why are we Moorish Americans? Because we're descendants of Moroccans and born in America. Here's the chink in our here in America. The only way we know how to identify is by the color code system, and somebody else gave us that. That's why I mentioned in the debate, again, I'm addressing people's psychology and common sense and reasoning. I'm like, show of hands, how many of you have said, or how many of you have seen what you would call a black Puerto Rican? A lot of hands went up. I said, okay, how many of you very same people have ever heard or said yourself, oh, that person was mixed Puerto Rican and black? The face with their own with their own bad thinking. If there's such thing as what they would call a black Puerto Rican, how can you be mixed Puerto Rican and black? I mean, come on. So for people to realize or acknowledge themselves that, wait a minute, something might be wrong with my thinking. And once we can get people to do that, now we can explain and it starts to make sense. There are other ways to identify people besides the one that your slave master gave you, which is the color code system of race. You see what I'm saying? So I'm like, he's off topic. I pointed out he was off topic. I explained why he was off topic, and then I went into my presentation. So that's what I thought about what he presented. It was just off. It was off. Now, mind you, he listened to a lot of other people. Shout out to Professor X in Los Angeles, California. He was one of the main people on his research team. But, again, that means his people helping him didn't know the topic either. There you go.
And as you're actually, you know, quoting certain things that comes out the lesson, I've actually got a question here, a question from Adam Brown, and he asked this. How can the Moors denounce the term black and in their lesson say God is white and exalt it over it? 101's 93, will you define the word white? White means purity, purity means God, and God means the ruler of the land. And at the same time, say in circle lesson number 19th or 1/9th degree, that death is a friend. 9, what is death? Death is a friend who, when the work of life is done, just cuts the cord that binds the human boat to earth, that it may sail on smoother seas. So I will just reiterate the question. The question is, how can they denounce the term black?
Yes. Well, first, there's a problem with the question. We don't denounce the term black. We don't denounce the term black. We don't have a phobia or a negative thing with the word black. If we say, and that's a great question, if we say that black according to science means death, and then at the same time say there's a holy ministry in death, and at the same time we say that death is not an enemy but a friend, then what are we saying? Here's another quote from the prophet. He said, according to all true and divine records, there is no Negro, black, or colored attached to the human family. So when we say black according to science means death, the only reason people take it personal is because they identify themselves with a color. What Noble Drolley is telling everybody is that it doesn't apply to you. There's no such thing. Okay? Black is a condition. In this case, for our people, a social condition. And that's why we say black according to science means death. They ask, what science? Take your pick. In the debate, I took sociology. And why is that important? Because we're talking about a people that have very substandard social conditions, our people in America and in other places as well. So then I mentioned in the debate, I said, if you don't know, if you claim you uplift fallen humanity or work to uplift fallen humanity, biology or social science, you are ill-equipped. And in sociology, red means stop, green means go, yellow means caution, black means purity. That's just what it is. In closed doors, behind closed doors, what black may mean to us, that's cool. But that doesn't exist in the open, in society at large. And even more so, we don't, it's just like racism. Racism isn't just a, well, I don't like you because of your race. It's, no, I can oppress you. I have the power to oppress you based on my dislike. So it's the same thing. It's like you don't got the power to redefine the word for society at large. You just don't. You can call it what you want to call it in your head amongst your group of people. That's cool. That's cool. But you don't define that in society at large. But my point being, again, I want to get to the topic. Black, according to science, means death does not mean that we denounce black. What we're talking about is that we know that it doesn't apply to people. You can apply it to whatever you else you want to apply it to as long as it's appropriate in context. Our brothers and sisters in Africa do not identify with black as an identifier for people. They don't. It's just that simple. The only people on the planet that do is our people here who've lost all knowledge of themselves, who've lost their national identity. We're the only ones that identify with a color. And we know the basic rules of English. An adjective doesn't identify, it only describes. What is it describing? It's describing our condition. It describes our social condition, our economic condition. It describes our political condition. That's what it does. So we don't denounce it, we just know how to use it. And that's what I said, one of the things I said in the intermission, in the interview. I said, we don't got a problem with black power, as long as we know what black power is. And then later on in the Q&A, I explained what black power is. And it's a shame, with all due respect, that somebody who studies Nile Valley culture does not understand the alchemical science of black and death and regeneration from it, which is where we get the word alchemy from anyway. Life out of death, green out of Osiris being painted black and green. No, I'm not done. White means purity. Purity means God. God means ruler of the land. See, it's one thing to cherry pick certain things out of the doctrine, out of our diary of the doctrine. So Noble Drew Ali did say white means purity, purity means God, and God means ruler of the land. He also said that man's ideal is his God. As man unfolds, his God unfolds. Man's God today, tomorrow ain't God at all. So even God is a man-made invented thing. If we want to be truthful about Allah, Allah is beyond thingness. Allah is not a God. A God is a fiction made by man. It's man's idea. So right back to social issues. White means purity. It meant purity in Egypt, in ancient Kemet. Don't get mad at me. You have to now question why and who told you to identify yourself with colors. There's the issue. That's the real problem. It hurts people because they attend themselves with adjectives and with colors, challenging them to look outside of that. That's all.
Strong, strong, strong. Okay, okay. Wow. You know what? The debate itself, I need to touch on this, I need to. The debate itself was, are we Moorish Americans or not? Okay? So, I want to know, if you was to conclusively prove that the descendants of the in Americas right now, you know what, are Moors, how could you definitively prove that the blacks or the Moors in America are who they say they are?
Brother, I tell you, man, I really have, I mean, over half of the slides that I had to present, I didn't even have time to present. Some of the biggest, to quote my brother, Sarah Sunsetti, some of the biggest daggers we had to throw, we didn't get a chance to throw. Specifically with that, I didn't get that far, unfortunately. But I will talk about them right now. I will talk about them today. Actually, I'm pulling up the slides. I'm not sure if I can share them, but I'm pulling up the slides as we speak.
Ooh, I think we're about to get another talk with the Titans exclusive right now. If you are able to pull up the slides, we do have a section on the Hangout section just on the left. that states or says screen share. So if we can get that pop in, oh man, that would be perfect.
All right, let's see if we can do that, brother. Let's see if we can do that. Hold on. So let's see. Screen share. All right.
It's going.
Can
down.
You all see?
It's not at the moment. You may have to click onto the actual tab. It gives you a selection of 3 or 4 different tabs to screen share. If it does, click on that one and it says present to everyone.
How about that?
Still no.
Let
me see.
How about that?
Let's have a look. Yep. It's completely black at the moment. Here we go. There we go. It's there.
All right. Let's start. That's one of the slides. Pope Eugene IV. He issued Ilias Qui in 1442. This papal bull licensed the Portuguese raids of the West African coast as a continuance of the Crusades and granted full remission of sins to those that took part in any expeditions against the Moors. In other words, what we're showing here were with actual documentation, historical documentation, that the entire transatlantic slave trade, the beginnings of the transatlantic slave trade, were specifically targeting the Moors that were expelled from Spain and selling them across the Atlantic into the Americas. So the Portuguese were doing raids looking for Moors. That alone tells you what? In the beginnings of the slave trade, across the transatlantic slave trade, you know, across the Atlantic, it was Moors being enslaved. And what it was a continuation of the Crusades on behalf of Christendom. It was a continuation, but it gets better. It gets better. There was that papal bull, there was another papal bull, Dum Diversus, which introduced the doctrine of discovery. And then the doctrine of discovery in continuing this whole thing of converting Moorish prisoners of war into perpetual slaves in addition to that was the exploration really was the intelligence gathering. The travels across the Atlantic by Cortez, by Columbus, right? And the travels into the interior of the African continent were for the purpose of determining the extent of Moorish dominions. That was the purpose. So you have three things. The expulsion of the Moors from Spain from 1485 to 1560. The age of discovery of the European, or based on the doctrine of discovery, which also was the foundation for the color code system of racism, also the foundation for manifest destiny, also the foundation for European colonialism and imperialism. In other words, it opened the door for them to begin to rule the world for the first time in history. It was done on the grounds or on old Moorish dominions. So we have the expulsion of the Moors from Spain, the transatlantic slave trade, and the quote-unquote discovery of America. They still, to this day, even though we know that they didn't discover anything new, they still use the term discovery of America. Why? Because it was under the doctrine of discovery authorized by the Pope. That's why. And all three of these things were to further prosecute the war against the Moors, the Crusades against the Moors. Now let me take it a step further. Yes, the Portuguese conducted raids to capture Moors, specifically the Moors expelled from Spain. They also went into Moorish dominions, where there were various tribes, tribes, etc. And they grabbed people there too. So they grabbed people under Moorish dominion in various tribes in West Africa and in parts of the Sahara. That's what they did. Now, What's interesting, again, remember, they were granted remission of sins for doing so. So let's just say, for instance, they grabbed some people that weren't specifically subjects of the Moroccan Empire. What do you think they put them in down in the books as to get credit for by the Pope? They put them down as Moors. So, sad to say, you know, we tell the truth whether it's good, bad, or ugly, right? Sad to say, any of our people on the African continent that got caught up in the transatlantic slave trade got caught up in Moorish beef. They were collateral damage. The fact of the matter is that the Portuguese and then later the Spanish were looking for Moors, and they sold them specifically and predominantly and primarily in the transatlantic slave trade. Matter of fact, let me read this in the last part of the slide. Captains, and this is from Professor Nazir Ahmed in his piece, The Transatlantic Slave Trade. Captain Goncalves and Tristão netted more than a dozen Muslims and enslaved them. Elated, Henry wrote to Pope Eugene IV, who gave a decree that capturing the Moors as slaves was a part of the crusade, and whoever sailed south in this pursuit would receive absolution of his sins. This was the origin of the slave trade, which, hold on, let me repeat that. Professor Nazir Ahmed says, this was the origin of the slave trade, which began with Portuguese piracy on the Moroccan coast in 1441. The process was systematized in 1444 when the Portuguese Lagos Company was chartered under the patronage of Prince Henry. Let's go on. Pope Nicholas V. He issued the papal bull Dum Diversus in 1452, authorizing Alfonso V of Portugal to reduce any Moors and any other unbelievers to perpetual slavery, thus facilitating the Portuguese slave trade from West Africa. He also issued the bull Romanus Pontifex in 1455, extending to the Christian nations of Europe, all of them, dominion over quote-unquote discovered Moorish territories during the Age of Discovery, also encouraging enslavement of native and non-Christian peoples in Africa and the New World, all done as a continued prosecution of the Crusades against the Moors. Dum Diversus, Romanus Pontifex, and Inter Cetera became the foundation for the doctrine of discovery, the global slave trade of the 15th and 16th centuries, and the age of imperialism, manifest destiny, and the social construct caste system of the color code system of race, which peaked in development and use in America. You all with me?
Yeah, we're following you. We're with you.
Yes, sir. Next slide. Look at the book. This book, The Discovery of America and Outgrowth of the Conquest of the Moors. That's the name of this book that you see. The discovery of America was a major part of the continued hostilities of European Christendom against the Moors. Hold on. Sorry. There we go. Against the Moors. It was a military expedition to determine the extent of African dominions. Let me fast forward to this one slide here. Can you see this slide right here with the map?
Yep, we can see it.
All right, beautiful. This comes from the Carta Marina of Frisius, 1525. What you see in the top part of in the quotes is written on the map in the book. We had this book translated from the Spanish. Okay? Narrative and Critical History of America, Spanish Explorations, page 127, Justin Windsor. But in the middle of the page, you can see, and then I have it printed in large print, issued in 1525, an exposition of his theories and sea charts. The map is of interest as the sole instance which North America is called part of Africa. There you go. Now, what did Noble Drolli have to say about this? Chapter 47, Moorish Science, Symbol of America, Holy Quran, the Moorish Science, Symbol of America, chapter 47. He said, Egypt, the capital empire of the dominions of Africa. That's chapter 47. Verse 7, it said their dominion and inhabitation extended from northeast and southwest Africa across the great Atlantis, even into the present North, South, and Central America, also Mexico and the Atlantis Islands, before the great earthquake, which caused the great Atlantic Ocean. This map you are looking at is proof of what the prophet said was 100% correct. More from Professor Nazir Ahmed in his piece, The Encyclopedia of Islamic History of the Atlantic Slave Trade. It is not commonly appreciated that the first target of slavery in West Africa were the Moors. The Portuguese and the Spanish referred to all Muslims, regardless of racial differences, as Moors. He says the Portuguese did that. Please don't think that that is the primary definition of a Moor. Anyway, let me continue. A description of the first raids has come down to us through the writings of the Portuguese writer Azarara. And then I had already read this part here. I didn't. In 1441, a certain young Portuguese captain, Goncalves, sailed along the coast of southern Morocco and Mauritania, gathering ivory, animal hide, and sea lion oil for sale in Lisbon. In a chance encounter, he met up with a Muslim couple, wounded the man with a javelin, and took them aboard ship as slaves. At the time, the jurisdiction over the Portuguese colony of Tangier was with Prince Henry, an enthusiastic supporter of a naval thrust along the Atlantic seacoast to outflank the Maghrib. The couple was presented to Henry. Sensing an opportunity to capture more slaves, he authorized an ambitious raid the same year under a seasoned and experienced Captain Tristão, who was familiar with the Atlantic coast of West Africa. Captain Goncalves and Tristão netted more than a dozen Muslims and enslaved them. Elated, Henry wrote to Pope Eugene IV, who gave a decree that capturing the Moors as slaves was a part of the crusade, and whoever sailed south in this pursuit would receive absolution of his sins. This was the origin of the slave trade, which began with Portuguese piracy on the Moroccan coast in 1441. The process was systematized in 1444 with the Portuguese Lagos Company. Second paragraph. The medieval popes claimed the right to dispose of conquered Muslim territories as well as the lands newly discovered by Europeans. The legal basis was the donation of Constantine. Under supervision of the Vatican, Spain and Portugal negotiated a treaty dividing the world into spheres of influence. A papal bull sanctified the Treaty of Tordesillas. It placed the line of demarcation between Spanish and Portuguese territories 370 leagues west of the Cape Verde Islands. West Africa, the Indian Ocean, and Brazil were allocated to Portugal. Spain received Europe, the Mediterranean, East Asia, and the Americas, except Brazil.
I kind of bogus today. I kind of had a pretty screen share.
Sorry, continue.
Okay. So, I mean, one of my other slides, the truth about the transatlantic slave trade. This is from History of Redemption on a Plan Entirely Original, exhibiting the gradual discovery and accomplishment of divine purposes in the salvation of man, including a comprehensive view of church history and the fulfillment of scripture prophecies, written in 1793 by Jonathan Edwards and David Austin. Besides the Protestant bloodshed and these persecutions, popery has to answer for the lives of millions of Jews, Mohammedans, and barbarians. When the Moors conquered Spain in the 8th century, they allowed Christians the free exercise of their religion. But in the 15th century, when the tables were turned and Ferdinand subdued the Moriscos, in other words, the descendants of the above Moors, many hundred thousands of them were forced to be baptized or burnt or massacred or banished, and their children sold for slaves. Besides an innumerable multitude of Jews who shared the same cruelties. Wow. Chiefly by means of the infernal Inquisition. A worse slaughter, if possible, was made among the natives of Spanish America, where 15 millions are said to have been sacrificed to genius of popery in the course of about 40 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Jeez.
This is the part of the history that's not talked about or told in America. But here's another reason why they got at us so hard. There we go. We think that Europeans did what they did to us and are doing what they do to us simply because, oh, well, they just hate us. No, no, no. That's part of it, but you have to ask why. You have to ask why. See, if you ask the very radical white supremacist groups, they will quickly tell you this history. But the reason why this history here is not widely known is because it does not support the system of racism. The system of racism implies that you were always inferior. Well, how can they support that always perpetual inferior status if you knew once upon a time you enslaved them? Here's the quote from the book Barbarian Cruelty. It was during the 1600s that the Barbary Corsairs, or pirates from the Barbary coast of North Africa, today Algeria, Libya, and Morocco, were at their most active and terrible. With the full support of the Moorish rulers of North Africa, these Muslim slavers raided southern Europe, the Atlantic European coast, Britain, and Ireland almost at will. Most estimates, based on the size of the Moorish cities, indicated that by 1780, at least 1.2 million Europeans had been seized. This remarkable book, first published in 1693, contains one of the few genuine eyewitness accounts written by a white slave who managed to escape. Its graphic description of the lot of white slaves, the Moorish relations with the Jews of North Africa, and the conditions of the time and the author's eventual escape cast a dramatic and nowadays oft-hidden light upon the time when whites were enslaved. Another book, the story of Thomas Pelow, who was another eyewitness. The book is called White Gold. Thomas Pelow in 1716 was a cabin boy, pardon the typo, cabin boy on a ship captured by Barbary Corsairs, which were Moorish pirates, sold to the Moroccan Sultan Moulay Ismail. Converted to Islam, why? To ensure his safety. There you go. We can keep going. Ray Irwin, in his doctorate's dissertation, Diplomatic Relations of the United States with the Barbary Powers, that's the name of the book. You can get this book on PDF. By the middle of the 16th century, Corsairs were raiding as far north as the Straits of Dover, snatching captives from the very shores of the British Isles. In the course of three centuries, it was estimated that the Algerines alone captured 600,000 slaves. While as late as 1798, a Tunisian foray carried nearly 1,000 people off a small Italian island, completely depopulating it. The insolence of these piratical states, fostered by an almost unaccountable submission to their pretensions by the Christian nations of Europe, has been strikingly exhibited in the conduct of the Bay of Algiers towards Captain Bainbridge on his arrival there in the frigate George Washington with the annual tribute. Let me stop right there. What are we reading here? We're reading here that America, the new nation of America, was paying tribute to the Bay of Algiers, just so they could sail up and down the eastern seaboard. Facts. The Bay replied, "You pay me tribute, by which you become my slaves, and therefore I have the right to order you as I think proper." All the tributary nations of Europe submitted, so he added, to render him like services. He later says in the book, "The first of the Barbary states is Morocco. The Berbers were the oldest inhabitants of the country, and the Moors were the descendants of those who had left Spain." You all there? You following?
Yeah, we're following. We're following.
Beautiful, beautiful. Next slide. this was my last slide dealing with this whole topic right here. The truth about your enslavement. Number one, the origin of the entire African transatlantic slave trade was a continuation of the Crusades against the Moors. Number two, the discovery of America was actually intelligence gathering and securing of Moorish dominions by Christendom. Number three, the construction of the color code system of race was designed to simultaneously hide you from your brothers and sisters and the rest of the human family, while at the same time creating a utopia and world power base for Europeans. Number four, racism and racial hostility against our people is the continued fear and hate of your ancestors, the Moors, being exacted upon the children, which is us. Also as an act of continued vengeance for wartime actions against Christendom, in other words, enslaving them. And lastly, your identity of Moor was your last legal name on the books. Dr. Ben, Chancellor Williams, Dr. John Henry Clark, Dr. Ivan Van Sertima, Sheikh Anta Diop, etc., all agree that Moors are African people. They and other scholars agree that via the Crusades, the African slave trade was focused on the Moors, and both Dr. Ben and Chancellor Williams affirm that we are the direct descendants of those Moors. But only Prophet Noble Drew Ali reconnected you to your erased and hidden past and directly told you who you are and who your forefathers were. He then laid the groundwork for our full enjoyment of self-determination unmolested by others. Any questions?
I don't think there is any questions. What more questions? That's literally the nail in the coffin. Like, what more proof do you need from that? Like, where do you go with this debate from there? I'm curious.
Yeah, like I said, we didn't even get a chance to hit a lot of this stuff. Here's one. You know, one of the things that I had challenged Brother Reggie on, but he backed out of this topic, was to prove a connection between our people in America and our people of ancient Kemet. He backed off of that. I didn't challenge him with the idea that it didn't exist. I challenged him because I knew that the only way he could show the connection was through the Moors. Mm. Hence this slide right here. Can you see the slide?
Yes, yes.
Here you go. You know, stolen legacy. Among other places, there's other scholars that talk about this, but this is, you know, one of the clearest. And I'm quoting from the book down here. The 8th century Moors, natives of Mauritania, were the recipients and the custodians of the ancient authentic tradition that was and is the mysteries of Egypt, and became so from a number of avenues. Much later, during the Persian, Greek, and Roman invasions of Egypt. Let me stop right there. Our brother Reggie tried to poke fun at the Moors, our forefathers, his forefathers too, by the way, getting kicked out of Spain by the Europeans, right? Right? Totally bypassing or ignoring the fact that centuries earlier, Egypt got its behind kicked. Kemet got its behind kicked by the Persians, Greeks, and the Romans. But anyway, let's continue. Much later, during the Persian, Greek, and Roman invasions of Egypt, large numbers of Egyptians sojourned to Arabia, Asia Minor, and North Africa, where the teachings of their mysteries greatly enhanced the already present ancient Egyptian teaching of the descendants of the ancient Moabites in Mauritania, North Africa. The Moors in the 8th century, as the neighbors of and safe haven for the Egyptians, were also in fact custodians and ambassadors of African culture that the known world at that time looked to for enlightenment. Further, the Moors had established caliphates in Baghdad, Cordova, and Cairo, thus maintaining a constant contact with Egypt, Europe, and Asia Minor simultaneously. There's your connection. We can draw a clear, solid line from ancient Kemet to North Africa, to the Moorish or the Moroccan Empire, from there to Europe, from there from Europe back to the continent of Africa and across the Atlantic to the Americas, right through to the transatlantic slave trade, right to the present. Noble Drew Ali said this, backwards through the ages, masterminds can trace themselves, and thus they know. This is tracing ourselves. Here's another one. Hold on. Dana Marnici, Dana Reynolds Marnici, powerful sister, former instructor of World Civilizations, Anthropology, and Sociology courses at Glassboro State College. Powerful, powerful sister. This is a quote from her piece, The Denigrification of Berbers and Canaanites. I hope y'all are ready for this one. The term Moor and its variants have long been used throughout Europe as synonyms for nigri or negro and to denote various black-skinned and nearly black peoples. In the last century or so, it's been presumed that ancient Moor, it has been presumed in the last century or so that ancient Moorish Muslims in the Iberian Peninsula were erroneously thought of as black by medieval Europeans. It has also been presupposed that the term Moro in the Iberian Peninsula originally denoted Saracens and Berber speakers that were distinct from modern blacks of Africa in phenotype and origin. It has been concluded that early Berber populations in North Africa were descendants of ancient Caucasoids who have absorbed different black African populations in recent times. Similarly, it is believed that the Arab populations of North Africa 1,000 years ago were mainly Caucasoid groups affiliated with the present populations of the Levant. Let me stop. What is she describing here? She's saying this is the European imperialist view that they forced upon the rest of the world when they gained power. I address this in the debate as what? The Hamitic hypothesis. In other words, how do we as Europeans explain how these darkies built all this high civilization when we say they can't put two nickels together? Oh, well, we're going to explain it by saying the people that actually did it were Caucasians. They just had dark skin, but they were actually Caucasians. It was the Hamitic hypothesis that informed Federal Directive 15, which now when you look at it in America, when you it says white also means the inhabitants of North Africa. Now you know where it came from. Simple. So let me continue. Historical documents, physical anthropology, archaeology, and traditional record in Muslim Africa and Asia, however, support the view that early Berber clans entering Europe were not only blacks and near blacks in the literal sense, but affiliated with early and current populations of the Fezzan, Mozab, Suratika, the Moroccan Rift, Sudan, Sahara, and Sahel-designated Garawa, Jarawa, or Wangara, and Zaghawa, Zaghai, or Songhai, the Tuareg as well, before intermingling with non-African populations, were undoubtedly representative of ancient populations called Mori, or Mezikes, in the Tripolitania, the Bentapolis, Kabila, the Ares, and Fezzan stretching from Nubia and east of the Nile. Both of these groups, along with the early Fulani and Peul and black vassal groups among the Tuareg, undoubtedly contributed to the Moorish or black element in Spain and southern Europe, and were the bulk of the groups traditionally classified as Berber, i.e. Senhaja, Godala, Masmuda, Zenata, Harawa, or Luwata. Anthropological race theories of the dark or black Caucasoid types, Hamite, Eurafrican, Mediterranean race, in other words, the Hamitic hypothesis, colonial conceptions of the Negro, and modern political constructs of blackness in Europe and of the Abid or slave in the Near East play a significant role in ethno-historic interpretations of the origins of early North African Berbers and Arabic speakers. The neglect in contemporary historiography of the biological impact of documented movements of various northern groups over the last several centuries into North Africa and the same latitudes in Asia, including the white slave trade, has had deleterious influence on early African historical study. What is she saying? She's saying that people, European imperialists, are saying that these people were not us, but somebody else. And Afrocentric thinkers are echoing those same Eurocentric mindsets. Let me continue. It is a second primary factor contributing to current theoretical constructs that dismiss the predominant role of populations of Black African and Afro-Arabian affiliation in the ethnic groups first designated Maori, Berber, and Arab. I think she makes the issue pretty clear. What you guys think?
Clear as day. Clear as day.
Any questions? We can keep going.
Yeah, you know what? I've got some questions here. Our comment section on YouTube is getting real crazy right about now. So I'm going to actually fulfill your requests and ask the good brother some questions. You know, bear with me. I'm going to pull them up right now. Questions asked or answered. Please type your questions into the comment section and also tag my name, Titans TV, towards it, and it will highlight it for me. So we've got a question here from Aubrey44, and he says, if during the slave trade our ancestors were able to keep their country and tribal names intact, Senegal, Ghana, Yoruba, Igbo, would the Moors feel it necessary to ID as Moor?
Oh, wow. Well, once again, you know, within an empire, you have tribal affiliations. You have all, you know, the diversity that tribal affiliation keeps or maintains within an empire. Now, of course, this is 2016. This is a new era of time. Nobody uses, you know, the world does not use the terms or use the structure, the political structure of empires, kingdoms, and dominions. But during that time period, they did. So let's bring it down to what we can understand is how, you know, statehood is understood today. If you live in the state of California, you could call that a dominion. If it has a capital, that means it has an empire. That capital is Sacramento. Make sense? Now, how many ethnic groups are within the state of California? But they're all called, what? California state residents. Does that make sense?
Yep.
It's really simple. Again, this, it's a great question because, once again, it points a finger at our lack of education on these matters. And why the lack of education? To keep you out of the knowledge of national identity. That's why. You see what I'm saying? So apply that now to the brother's question. The term Moor, in this case, we're talking about an empire, not a tribe, not an ethnicity, not a race. We're talking about a political entity that within it had tribalism. Does that make sense?
Yes, completely.
There we go. And now, as it relates to us today, that is the best term to describe the African diaspora. Especially since the African diaspora as it exists here came as a result of the transatlantic slave trade.
Mm-hmm. And we've got another question here. This question, bear with me for 1 second. Let's just have this rotating. This question here is from Deliver the Nation. And it says, question, would the Olmecs be Moors as well?
Good question. Again, I want to reiterate, if you say Moor, we have to be, you know, we have to be clear, okay? We're not talking about necessarily a race, right? Not necessarily. We're talking about, in this case, political affiliation. We also are talking to a degree, you know, some ethno-specificity, okay? Now, let's talk about the people that were labeled Olmecs, because they didn't call themselves that. We know that the term Olmec means the rubber people, and that was a name given to them by the Spaniards because of the rubber tree trade when they were there occupying the land. That being said, we know that there was a pre-Columbian transatlantic intercourse between continental Africa and the continental Americas. What we're dealing with here, and I want to touch on this is important, because there's certain standards of thinking that shape our thinking, which now also shape our research and our understanding. You have two schools of thought here when we're talking about anthropology and archaeology. One is isolationism. The other is diffusionism. Isolationism posits that cultures developed independently over thousands of years and had very little to no contact between them. And if they have similarities, it is only by chance. Diffusionism states that ancient cultures enjoyed thousands of years of cross-cultural pollination and had intercourse and interaction. Now, the question you need to ask yourself is, which one of these ideologies supports white supremacy? This is important, okay? So, dealing with the Olmecs, if we're thinking like isolationists, we have a hard time wrapping our head around the possibility that there was contact from African inhabitants or inhabitants from Africa in the Americas pre-Columbian era. But if we are thinking from the diffusionist mind state, it just makes sense. Now, if we can understand the isolationist ideology, we know that the isolationist ideology supports white supremacy. Hence, the Smithsonian Institution being notorious in the 1800s and early 1900s of dumping tons of American artifacts in the Atlantic Ocean. Hence, the area of the Grand Canyon to this day that the Smithsonian Institution hired the surveyor Kincaid in 1831 to map is still off limits and under guard by black helicopters and black, you know, and black suited troops to this day. You know, there's a lot of things going on, people. It's pretty interesting, and it's not spooky or pseudo. It's very real. You know, it explains why, you know, about what, 15 years ago, I believe, they did some DNA testing on hair follicles of Egyptian mummies and found the presence of cocaine. And you can only find the coca leaf in Central and South America. So that demonstrated or proved cross-cultural pollination between the African, at least the Egyptians or the ancient Kemetic people and people in the Americas going back as far as 10,000 years. So I say all that to say this, brother, to answer the brother's question. I want to say those things. To answer the brother's question, will we consider Olmecs as Moors? Let me be very specific. We would consider, as Moorish Americans, members of the Moorish Science Symbol of America, we would consider the Olmecs denizens and constituents within Moorish dominions. That's how we would put it.
Excellent. As well, I realize that your camera angle is still on the screen sharing mode at the moment, and it'd be wonderful to see your face.
Sure.
I'm going to go into some of these questions because, you know what, we've got some brothers and sisters on here that have got real interesting questions, such as Var Williams. My question for the brother would be this. With all the greatness associated with melanin that predates 711, the year the Moors went into Spain to educate the Europeans, why is it that the Moors only want to be known as Moors when there's plenty of melanated greatness that we can associate and define ourselves by that predates 711?
Oh, wow. That's a good question. But, you know, before I can quite answer it, I want to dissect the question a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking at the question now. With all the greatness associated with melanin, well, and again, I don't mean to be facetious, and I don't want to, and I know what the brother's saying, but I don't want to be facetious in saying this, but remember, melanin is a molecule. I'm not belittling melanin, but understand, our greatness doesn't come from a molecule, brother man. It doesn't come from a molecule. Man is not the body or the soul, which means man ain't a molecule either. Okay? But I won't, let me continue. I understand what he's saying. Greatness associated with melanin, I would presume he means the greatness associated with our people. Right? That predates 711, the year the Moors went into Spain to educate the Europeans. Why is it that the Moors only want to be known as Moors when there are plenty of melanated greatness? Here we go. Prophet Noble Drawley said it this way. He said, I have reconnected the broken wires and mended them to the higher powers. What he meant by that is he reconnected us back to the human family. What I mean by the human family is that now we can directly trace ourselves to the very greatness in ancient time that you speak of. But when there's a missing link, all you could do is look at that ancient greatness and say, yeah, that's us, but with no definitive way of connecting yourself. You see what I'm saying? So we're not, when we say Moorish American or Moors, we're not isolating ourselves to what happened in Spain, 711 AD. What we're doing is we're putting the final puzzle piece back in so through that we can connect to ancient Kemet and beyond and around it. That's the point. It's not isolating ourselves to just Moors. What it's doing is putting in the missing piece and reconnecting ourselves to our ancient forefathers in real time. So in a way that, you know, like the European Jewish woman, Mary Leskovitz, you know, Lefkowitz in the book, Not Out of Africa. The reason why she could write such a book is because she knows we are absent of national identity and can't make the solid link. That's why she could write that book. But when you bring this history up, they can't deny it. They're like, okay, yes, you are connected to the ancient people of the Nile Valley. And this is how you're connected to the ancient people of the Nile Valley. The people in Morocco, or ancient, the ancient Moorish Empire, did not, as Brother Reggie tried to imply, did not plagiarize from ancient Kemet. There were the ancient Kemites. They were their descendants, straight up and down. George D.M. James said it. Dr. Ben said it. I mean, take your pick. You know, so I hope I answered the brother's question. You know, it's what connects us to the rest of the African diaspora in a definitive and real way. It doesn't isolate us.
Excellent. Well, you know, we've got a few questions from Brother Anaim, Ben Hazrael. But before we go into every single one of those questions, I just want to preface that I'm only going to ask one question, and I'm going to bring it back to another question a little bit later on due to the shortness of time that we have remaining. So, could you provide insight into the Mauritian Temple of America's understanding of Jahiliyyah, the age of ignorance preceding the revelations of the Prophet Muhammad, and how it relates to non-Islamic cultural and spiritual paradigms? In other words, what are the Prophet's teachings relative to the broad diversity of wisdom-based traditions which exist outside the context of social or historical Islam? Can they be defined as divine despite their lack of Quranic guidance? And if so, what is the criteria or measurement or measuring rod which determines that?
Powerful question. Powerful question. Okay. Let's start with this. It is very, and this is also a problem amongst a lot of our people with the House of Consciousness. What they're doing a lot of times is looking at the past with modern eyes. You can't. You can't. You have to do the due diligence to take on eyes of the past to look at the past. You have to look at it the way it was then. You understand what I'm saying? For instance, the way we see Islam today, we presume this was the look and complexion of Islam during the time of Prophet Muhammad, or during the Ottoman era, or during, you know, the era of Ali, as you know, and it's just not true. And truth be told, the complexion that Islam, the political and social complexion that so-called mainstream Islam has today, is very recent. in the YouTube chat on this live stream, somebody mentioned Saudi Arabia, right? You know when Saudi Arabia's 1926 prior to that there was no Saudi Arabia. What you see in terms of Islam today, the complexion of Islam, is really what it is. Islam, prior to the rise of Wahhabism, looked like what many of us would call a New Age religion today. For instance, the practice of Candomblé and Obeah, right, in South America, in Brazil. You know what's predominantly practiced by Muslims as a part of their Islamic tradition? The tradition of Ifa was greatly expanded on and adopted by early Muslims as a part of the Islamic tradition. Now, of course, today, that would be considered forbidden. Why? It has nothing to do with religion as to why it's considered forbidden today. Which you have a lot today masquerading as religious indifference in Islam and outside of Islam. And religious intolerance is really not religious intolerance at all. It is socio-political intolerance masquerading as religious. And that is rife in Islam today. The reason why you see the complexion of Islam being predominantly Wahhabist is because not because of a greater revelation or a greater understanding of what Muhammad brought, but because of the natural resources under their feet in the Middle East. That's the truth. So that was, so for instance, our practice of Islam in the more scientific of America, we say is much more pure than what they're practicing. One of the reasons is attributed to the brother's question, you know, about quote-unquote non-Islamic cultural and spiritual paradigms. What is determined as non-Islamic today? A lot of what is determined now has nothing to do with religion at all. It has nothing to do with the religion of Islam at all. It has everything to do with political decisions made by people in power in the Middle East, masquerading as Islamists and backed by the British crown.
All right. As well, I'm going to ask this question as well from one of our sisters, I believe it's from Kar Nepti. And it says here, if he has, or if Sharif Bey has, the Black Law Dictionary, 3rd edition, 1897 copyright, the word more has a quite different definition. I'd like him to elaborate on the defined term as related to what's in the aforementioned book.
Black's Law, 3rd edition. Hold on a second. There we go. It's interesting that you would bring that up. I just actually happen to have a copy. I'm not at home. I'm actually in my office in my business. I just actually happen to have a copy of Black's Law, 3rd edition, published in 1933. Not in 1897, but actually 1891. And the definition given of more is an officer in the Isle of Man who summons the court for the several sheddings. The officer is similar to the English bailiff of 100. Actually, the answer is quite simple. It's a legal dictionary. So it's talking about legal terms, not talking about a person, it's talking about another type of court. So it's really out of context as it relates to identity of the people. There's the answer. That's the simple answer.
Okay. Let me keep on going because we've got so many questions here. Let me diversify the questions. Let's go straight back onto YouTube as well. You know, I'm actually going to be investing in a international, hopefully toll-free or local rate line because I know we have so many people from all around the world that actually watches the show, tunes in. They may not have the Hangouts, and they want to actually call in and ask our brothers and sisters, who are the Titans, certain questions, as well as when we're going to start incorporating a debate into it as well. So please look out for that. And just give me, you know what, just drop down in the comment section literally what country or what state you are in, okay? So I'm going to try to make it definitely free for those people who come from a particular location. So hopefully in the UK, it's going to be a free number. In the USA, it's going to be a free number as well. If you're calling from Canada, Thailand, where do we have people calling from? Norway, Netherlands, France. You know, let me know exactly where you're calling in from, and hopefully I can just drop you lot a number where you can call in free from to have a dialogue with our reigning Titans. Okay, so we've got some questions here on, let's see in the comment section. You know, there's so many questions. Okay. Brother Sharif, can you provide any documentations or artifacts showing pre-colonial African countries or tribes in West Africa, Ghana, Senegal, Cameroon, Angola, etc., referring to themselves as Moors?
Oh, wow. I actually already did that in the presentation. As a matter of fact, I'll quote it again, but there's a number of, you know, there's a number of scholars and archaeologists, anthropologists, and sociologists that have already done this work for us. Besides, of course, Dr. Ben, besides Sheikh Anta Diop, besides, Stanley Lane Poole, Budget Meekin, but some of the most cutting-edge stuff. Again, I refer back to my sister, Dana Marnici, and she's straight up and down, you know, in like in the piece she did, the denigrification of Berbers and Canaanites. There's another piece did that's extremely powerful that it speaks to this and provides the proof that that the gentleman is looking for, who asked the question, or whoever asked the question. I'm sorry. One of the pieces is called "Recovering from the Hidden Ethnogenesis of Early African and Afro-Asiatic Peoples." Comprising the Moors of North Africa and Spain, the African heritage and ethno-history of the Moors, background to the emergence of early Berber and Arab peoples from prehistory to the Islamic dynasties. I had another piece of work from her, actually it was from a direct conversation with her and one of our comrades, where she provided us, and I don't know if I could find it, I'll try to find it, I may not have it here, but she provided us a list of modern tribes on the continent of Africa that they themselves speak to, tracing themselves back to Canaanites and Moorites. So if I can find it, I'll shoot it to you. If not, and maybe I'll shoot it at a later date. But there's a ton of information. There's a ton of history. Dr. Ben himself, as a matter of fact, in one of my quotes, speaks to the archaeological history. Matter of fact, I'm quoting it. I'll quote it. It comes from Africa, Mother Western Civilization, where he said, "The original Berbers and Moors were black Africans who spread from East Africa to Libya and Northwest Africa in the prehistoric ages. These people were the founders of various cultures, relics, litter caves in the Sahara." Where he said, "The original Berbers and Moors were black Africans who spread from..."
Sorry, continue.
Oh, okay. And he says, "They have continuously occupied the Central Sahara for more than 40,000 years. Their language, Tamazight, and its various dialects are recognized as a branch of the Afro-Asiatic phylum of African languages. The African Moors' extensive knowledge of ancient Egypt was due to their constant cultural exchange with their indigenous African brothers of Egypt through their caliphates." Okay, that's furthermore the quote, but it addresses the inquisitor's question regarding historical, linguistic, archaeological proofs of peoples in West Africa having connections to the Moors, even in name. I'll give you another example. This was an eyewitness. This was the day of the debate, and I mentioned it during the debate. Many of the people of Senegal openly and plainly call themselves Mora or Mori. Openly. You know, so...
Thank you. You know what?
There it is.
There you go.
Yes, go ahead.
Real quickly.
Can I get a quick question in?
Yeah, of course you can. Of course you can. I'm going to literally open up right now. Could someone just mute their mics? Mute their mics, please. There's a strong echo. Yes, I'm going to literally open it up right now for our panel members right now to actually ask our brother any questions that they will. If you would like to get in with the panel, because we've actually got about 20 minutes left of the live show, I'm not too sure if we're going to do an after show today, as it is 2 o'clock already in the morning. But if you can, just inbox me if you would like the link on Facebook. My Facebook address is Kalam, K-A-L-A-M-S-P-S-P-E-L, and inbox me in there, and I will try my very best to include you into this live panel discussion. So what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to open it up to Wally Aktab, Sick the Black Falcon, you know, to give any questions, commentary, or suggestions to Brother Sharif Bey.
Yo, thanks. Peace to everybody on the panel. Peace, Sharif Bey. I had a really quick question. I just wanted to know, between the Moors that we have from back in our ancient time, the Egyptians, the people in the Congo, the Nubians, the people of Ethiopia, what was our biggest mistake as far as how we got into this situation? If we had such a strong team throughout Africa, how did we get into this situation to where we are now divided amongst all of our tribes?
Brother, thank you. That is an amazing and sober question. The reason why, I want to, before I answer it, I want to say why I really am appreciative of the question, brother, because that type of questioning comes from a responsible mind. One of the poisons, the mental poison that's grown up in our people in America, due to the disenfranchisement and the disassociation with an identity, is, you know, we want to medicate ourselves. So we end up having this false narrative that prior to the coming of the European or the pale man, we lived in a heaven on earth and we were all one and everything was beautiful and everything was like the Garden of Eden, and that couldn't be the furthest thing from, that's the furthest thing from the truth. There's no way in the world that we could build pyramids and all do all this great stuff, and then a man just out of the Dark Ages comes into civilization and masters all of us. That couldn't happen without our participation in some shape, form, or fashion. So now to answer your question, even the whole idea of Pan-Africanism in America is really not understood. It's not, we don't understand it as Pan-Africanism. It's not what Pan-Africanism really is. That's my point. We think Pan-Africanism is, oh, well, everybody in Africa is all one people. That's not the truth. Prior to the advent of the European himself, we had wars and conflicts and battles and intrigue. Let's just be real. When it comes to political, in other words, the nations and tribes and whatever on the continent of Africa, we've never been unified. Ever. You see what I'm saying? We've never been unified. We don't know what that looks like. But since we've had an absence of national identity, all we see is Africa. We're nations on the continent that exist today. You see what I'm saying?
So would you say the reason that it was so easy to conquer us is because half the time the West didn't know what was going on in the East and vice versa? There was no communication?
We were the reason why is that we were already divided amongst ourselves. Let's talk about the Moors. And again, we tell, here's the thing about us as Moorish Americans. We strive to tell the truth even if it's against ourselves. So let's talk about it. I showed the slides about how the Moors engaged in slavery. We did engage in slavery. That means your forefathers and my forefathers, we all did. We are now reaping the results of our own problems. Noble Draly said it this way. He said, through sin and disobedience, every nation has suffered slavery due to the fact they honor not the creed and principles of their forefathers. In other words, we bit into the fruit from the forbidden tree. We got into human trafficking. But we didn't care who you were. And we really preferred enslaving those pale Europeans. We enslaved millions of them and did all kinds of dirt to them, too. Now, this is one of the other things that we did. And I'm just telling the truth. One of the highest and most expensive commodities amongst the European slaves were the European women. Our leaders had children by them and then educated those children in our universities. But then those children were getting a second set of instructions from their mothers. And so what you had within a generation to two generations is that the leadership became bleached out. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, yes. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is try to limit the questions just to one question so everybody on the panel can actually get their questions answered as well. Please, please, please. You know, we've got three rules on Talk with the Titans. The first rule is to keep your mics muted at all times. Second rule is to respect another person's cipher, and please do not interrupt them. The third rule is please, no profanity. This is a family-friendly environment where we have children actually viewing and participating in the shows as well. So I'm going to open it up now to Brother Garfield. If somebody else would like to speak after Brother Garfield, just give me a sign. And open up your mic real quickly and just close it, and I'll know that you're next. Okay.
Yeah,
we've got Brother Garfield that's going on next. Then we've got Terry, and then we've got Brother Khonsu. All right.
Let me use my peace and blessings, man. Peace and blessings and black power to Brother Sharif. Peace and blessings and black power to the panel, Sister Courtney, Khonsu. Khonsu, this is what I'm going to do, man. I'm going to give you my time because I'm actually bringing up a source on my computer, the question that I want to ask. So, Khonsu, you could take my time, and I'll just take your time, all right, because I want to be thorough with the question that I have for the brother, all right?
Okay, excellent. So this is what we're going to do then. I'm going to go straight to Brother Terry to ask the question, and then, Khonsu, you are next.
Yes, Mr. Bay. I want to ask a question. Because I'm very reluctant in the part of Nigeria and Portugal. As I'm from Nigeria, we have a thing where what you class as the Moors coming on from the north, coming into Nigeria before the Portugal slave trade. The problem that I have is that where I'm from, we were at war. Yeah. So I want to know if you know if we was into the forms of slavery.
Could you repeat it yourself? I couldn't hear the last part.
Could you?
There.
Hello.
Yes, Brother Terry, could you just repeat the question?
Yeah, I want to know if he was clear on understanding of the war between the Yorubas and the Fulani houses at the time of when the Portuguese kidnapped slaves. Did you hear that?
Oh, was I familiar with the Fulani and the conflict between Yoruba and Fulani? Vaguely, and again, there are many, many things that I don't know. You know, we have a team. Ali's men is a team. Certain areas where I'm not so clear, maybe my brother is. But I'm the first to admit if there's something I don't know, I'll tell you I don't know. I'm vaguely familiar with the conflicts between those two. I'm not quite sure how that relates to the issue with the Portuguese.
What's happened is that the Portuguese kidnapped, the first time they kidnapped were like 235 slaves in 1444,
yes,
around August.
Yes, sir.
And
yes,
predominantly were slaves of Igbo and Yorubas. which they had their own personal cultures.
Yes.
And mostly anyone that was to deal with the Moors were mostly like Hausas and Fulanis.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the guys that I would class them that would more be close to the Moors or anything else.
Right. Okay. One of the things that I pointed out earlier on this show, with one of my slides, is that the Portuguese marauders, that I'm not saying that every single individual, we're not saying that every single individual that they grabbed identified with the Moorish Empire.
Mm-hmm.
What we are saying is that when they were grabbed and captured by Portuguese, the Portuguese did identify them thusly because that's who they were commissioned to steal.
Okay, thank you. Now we're going to go over to either Brother Consu or Garfield to actually speak.
Consu, you ready? Or you want me to go?
If you're ready, Garfield, I'll yield.
Go ahead. I'll go after you, beloved. You're older than me anyway.
Oh, man, that hurts. Brother Sharif, in light of understanding languages and the region of Africa, when we go into six classifications of Afro-Asiatic, Nilo-Saharan, Niger-Congo A, Niger-Congo B, which is normally Bantu, Khoisan, Austrosian, usually that's conducive to Madagascar. We have to also look into the regions. You know, we have the Maghrib region, we have the Sahel region, we have the Western Sub-Saharan going into the southern region of Africa. And the reason I say all of this is the term, I would like you to define and give definition to the English rendered term Moorish, and what is the connotation and denotation of the word Moorish.
As it relates to what you mean and what you spoke of just recently, just now, with language, phenotype, and region.
Yes, and the term Moorish that has been used, I almost want to say it's a colloquial term that is being used in the place classified as Northern America.
Okay, beautiful. The whole issue with phenotype and, with phenotype, language, and region, right, is interesting. An individual was talking about, was trying to make a case of this, of that, you know, to use as a distinguishing factor between different groups, with Professor Dana Marnici at a particular point. And he was talking about, you know, genetics and haplogroups and these things, which is all great information. And she admitted, that's great information. She goes, but there's one thing that that information doesn't take into account, and that's migration. So I wanted to qualify my answer with that first. Now, the term Moorish, you know, we're just dealing with basic English in this respect as we use it, because we use the term Moorish American, right? The suffix ish means of or belonging to, like Irish. No one says, you know, in other words, we want to use it in the proper context. No one says Irish means sort of like Ireland. It means, they know it means of the people of Ireland or of things from Ireland, right? They know that's what it means. So we use the term Moorish in the same sense, of the Moors, of the Moors. You see, so when we say like Irish American, there's Moorish American, you know, Spanish American. That's the same connotation. When we say Moorish American, we're saying we are American citizens descent. And when we speak of Moorish descent, we're talking in some respects phenotypical, but more in the larger sense, we're talking political, socio-political, relating to the empire and to the dominions that the empire controlled at a particular point in time. That's what we mean. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, fair enough.
Thank you. Okay, before I go to you, Garfield, I think we've got Dolo. Is that you there, King? Your mic is muted, so just unmute your mic. Just hit the unmute button on your device. It's literally by hitting the touching the screen where your face is, and it should give you the option to unmute your mic.
Islam, Mo. How y'all feel?
Islam. Good, brother, man.
Yeah. King of the Moors, I am king. I just want to give you a shout-out, Sharif Bey, you know, for, you know, not falling for the trap, you know what I'm saying, and also the debate. And how you did your thing. I was behind the situation. I wanted you to win all the way, even though we don't debate like you said. You know, we got the same birthday, December 9th, so we had to be up in there. You know, I just wanted to say thank you for
Yes, sir.
You know how we do, you know, since the 90s, you know what I mean?
I appreciate you, brother. I definitely appreciate that.
Yeah. And, you know, what I'm doing, you know, just for the record, I'm bringing everybody together. I just want some unity. And sometimes, you know, for unity, you know how that go. You got to destroy and you need to build back up. So for the record, I just want to let everybody know that I'm about love, truth, peace, justice, and freedom, the five principles all the way. And that's just for the record, you know. Like I said, congratulations. Keep doing your thing, baby.
Thank you, sir.
Peace. Islam.
Islam. Okay, now I'm going to go straight into Brother Garfield, and afterwards we've got D. Miller, who's with us as well from Moabit. So, Garfield, the floor is open to you.
Yeah, man. Hey, peace and blessings, Brother Sharif Bey. Black power, brother. Black power all day. Black African power. Represent Team Osiris. We are on the horizon. Big up to the Amun Ra Squad and the Masi Clan. Let me say this before I even ask you a question. Are you saying my understanding of Moors, because I'd never heard of Moors before in my life, before I came from Jamaica. I have something to say before I even ask my question. One, are you a linguist that reads the Medioneta? Two, it's not a question. I mean, you could answer after I ask a question, but I just need to be clear if you're a linguist. And two, are you saying that Moors are from Moabites, and do you acknowledge the God of the Moabites? All right? So before, don't answer yet. You could answer after I ask the question, the official question. My official question has to do with two articles, one written by Sanjeti, from the Amun Ra Squad, and the other one written by my brother Jonathan Owens. The article by the brother Sanjeti was written July 31st, 2010, when his article is called A Linguistic Analysis of the Word Moor, Greek or Kemetic. I'm not going to go through the whole article, but I'm going to read his conclusion. His conclusion, in conclusion, detailed study of history, genetics, social sciences, and linguistics is extremely important for scholastic study. Whenever a new find comes to the forefront dealing with a cultural connection and history, it is our responsibility to research every angle before coming to final conclusions. We must keep in mind this is our history, which is world history, and we must embrace primary research and facts. His conclusion basically was because a lot of Moors like to say the MR or the MYR or the IMYR has a special meaning to Moor. All right? So let me read the end part now. I don't want to get too much into Sanjeti. Let me read the end part now to my brother Jonathan. He says, as for Ta Mary, meaning Moor, land of the Moor, or what have you, I will ask one of my Moorish brothers to please produce the literature. Even if you have to write it, come with the documents, provide the primaries, and I will also ask him to teach me the ancient Moorish language and the Moor script, please. Until then, I'll say, no, more Kemet, no Kemet, no more. He says, Atheots neo matamaros, to be qualified to make a statement of the such, one should at least possess the prowess to scrutinize primary documents or source material in its original language. Dr. Wesley Muhammad, he paraphrased him. So I ask you, on the Egyptian, is there any form of the word more, or is the word more on the glyphs in Egypt?
Okay, well, you asked a number of questions, and then you read that, and then you asked me the final question. Let me address the first question. I am not a linguist. Nothing in my presentation on the debate or in probably any of my writings, that's not my focus. That's not my focus at all. I know that Dr. Ben is versed or was versed in linguistics of the area. Our sister Dana Marnici is as well. I was supposed to be the person that asked that. My brother and your fellow squad, Brother Ishmael Bey, has already written a number of pieces on this very topic. I wouldn't be the one to ask the question because I'm not versed in linguistics. I'm not approaching it from a linguistic perspective, nor do I subscribe to the thought or believe that you must be a linguist to understand these matters. I'm talking about the matters in general about national identity. Now, linguistics, yeah, you got to be a linguistic, or you got to be a linguist to understand linguistics. I don't believe that you must be a linguistic to understand national identity and the history of it. So I'm not a linguist, so you'd be asking the wrong individual that question, sir.
All right, but how do we put a stop? Let me say this, though, to follow up, not a question. How do we put a stop to all these words that just happens to have MR in them to mean more? When are we going to put a stop to this? It is so ridiculous. I am so, right now, brother, I'm going to hold back because out of respect for Ishmael Bey, you're his brother, and he's a part of the squad. I'm going to hold back, but I'll say this. I don't think the Moors, I was shocked watching the debate, and I'm thinking about how the Moors think, and seeing that I'm a brother, that these are the biblical history, and how I go at the Hebrews, it seems like I'm going to have to take up the mantle and start studying Moorish history. Because what I'm hearing, and it seems like you guys fit in the same paradigm as the Hebrews in this sense, the Moors need to unite with the Moors. That's what they need to focus on. Just like I tell the Hebrews, they need to focus on uniting with the Hebrews first. Because that blockage of you being a Moor is blocking certain types of unity. Not Ishmael, and I don't know about you. I don't know you personally, but Ishmael is different in a sense because he does say he's a black African person. And he doesn't fall into that trap of Moor means black and all this craziness. But on a whole, there seems to be a blockage of uniting. Although Sonnet didn't express himself in the best of ways, because you guys came in the best of manners and definitely were very disciplined that day. So I'm going to say this. The Moors need to work on uniting with other Moors before they think about uniting with other black people. You know why? Because there's a stigma in the community about Moors. And I saw it. Sunday, I actually saw it. I never believed it because I'm around Ishmael. I don't see it with Ishmael. But when I see how the other Moors think, and with the questioning that they have, sometimes when you're in the Moorish community, you don't see it. But from the outside looking in, I'm not a Moorish historian, but when you guys talk about Moabites and stuff, it gets into my biblical lane. But I'm just saying, from my vantage point, Moors have a better chance to unite with their own before anybody else, just like with Hebrews. And I'll just leave it right there.
Well, I'll respond to that. And well, first, there's a measure and a degree of disunity, and I believe the disunity you're speaking of is doctrinal. And there's a measure, I mean, because there's different types of disunity. There's economic disunity, social disunity, political disunity. Okay, I can admit that. There's a ton of it in the Moorish community, but there's a ton of it everywhere else as well. You know, so in that respect, I would agree. We need a Moorish American Orthodoxy. But you know what? So does Nile Valley. You know what? So do the Hebrew Israelites. You know what? So do the atheists. So do the Christians. So in that respect, if we want to sit and wait for a doctrinal unity to be achieved amongst the separate groups, then we'll be in this place 120 some odd years from now having the same argument, because the real root of the issue is human weakness. That's what we're really dealing with here. It's not even so much of a doctrinal disunity. Now, but to your point, we could say the same thing about the Nile Valley community and a whole bunch of other people when we can sit here and to Brother Reggie that the term black doesn't identify, it describes by the basic rules of English. One, two, not a one of you can prove that people, I'm not talking about so-called dark matter, I'm not talking about melanin molecules, I'm talking about people, not a one of you can prove that you are a black person. Now, when you can do that, then we can also start talking about doctrinal unity amongst Moorish Americans.
All right. You know what? I'm going to quickly go over to our brother Eshu or D. Miller L. To ask his question. I think this is literally our rounding up questions because we don't have enough time left. We've literally gone over. So go ahead, D. Miller. Ask a question.
Peace, Colin. I want to say peace to you. Great job. Titans TV is awesome. Definitely one of the dopest platforms that we have to get out this information. Shouts out to my brother Sharif Islam, or?
Islam, brother man.
Good job, brother. Keep up the good work. Peace to the chat. Peace to everybody. Ali's in. Definitely doing works. My question, brother, since you went over a lot of history, is there a historical connection with the Moors and the Maroons of the Caribbean? Those people there, historically, can you kind of trace that? I don't know if you had that in the presentation or not, if that was later or if that was even there at all.
Well, actually, you know, I thought about putting it in. Actually, let me tell you, my presentation had over 65 slides. There was just no time. I barely got through half of them. And there was one point I was considering.
Brother Sharif, your signal. Brother Sharif, your signal is horrible, brother.
On maroonage, that this is that better?
Yes, much better.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'll repeat what I was saying. First of all, it's a great question. I initially had planned on putting an entire segment of my presentation for my debate on maroonage. And I just didn't have the time, brother. There was no way. My presentation had over 65 slides, and I barely got through half of them. So I just couldn't do it. But there was no need to do it. You know, there was no need really when a number of other people have already covered it very well. As a matter of fact, I would say that one of the strongest authorities amongst us on maroonage and its connection to Islam and its connection to the Moors is our brother Ismail Bey of the Amun-Ra squad. His connections in Florida and in other places, I mean, they've got some amazing research. They have some amazing, and I would defer to that brother on that particular issue. But I am familiar with the connection, the Islamic connection, and the Moorish connection, with maroonage, like I said, in Moorish identity. So there is definitely a connection, a very solid one, but it's just not talked about much, and a lot of people can't access it. But the person to talk to about that would be Brother Ismail Bey.
Okay. All right. You know what? you know, we've sadly run short of time. We've run out of time. We're definitely going to have behind-the-scenes conversations, and I've got tons more questions that I would love to actually ask you. But, you know, sadly, we've run out of time. But I would want to know, will you be available? Will you be free? If we give you the call out, will you be able to come back in and, you know, give us a part two of, you know, the debate slides that you weren't able to show, that you've got stored in the background somewhere? Will you be able to come back on to answer some more questions and actually present some more slides and more research that you yourself and the Ali's men have done throughout the years as well?
Brother, I would love to do that on one condition. And that condition would be that I can bring in a number of my other brothers with Ali's men that can hear from their perspective as well. Because, again, it's not just people see me, they see Sharif and Ayel Bey, and they say, oh, okay, well, let me tell you. We got some scholars, we got some soldiers with us, that and we're all sharp in our respective areas. We got some people with us, I'm telling you. So if I could bring some of them in so they can share their expertise from their perspective and their strengths, then definitely you have. Absolutely.
All right, excellent, excellent. All right, we're going to get this happening. We're definitely going to get this happening. Let me know as well in the comment section on YouTube land if you would love to see this take place. Now I have to give my loves and shouts to everybody who is actually in the audience, member audience as well in YouTube land. I see you lot. I give thanks to you lot. I'm seeing that you lot, as forever, are very cautious of the time that we have over here in the UK. It is definitely 2:37 over here in the UK, and some people are saying, yeah, Calamel definitely needs to get his sleep. All right, so I'm going to thank you. Let's see. Let me give my quick shouts. I have to give my shouts because without the audience members, you know what, we wouldn't be here. So shouts to you, Asen Murray, to Hotep, Robin White, The Truth Hurts. Are You Correct as well, and Born Out Allah. We've got so many different people that's actually with us today. Thank you for joining us. Born Out Allah again. Yeah, peace to you, Asen Murray. Peace to everybody. Now I want to know, is everybody here going to be able to stay behind for a little bit longer to actually have a conversation with the Team Osiris brothers, to have conversation with Dolo and our UK brothers as well? I believe everybody here is going to be here for a little bit longer, at least 20 odd minutes or so. So we're going to definitely have behind the scenes conversations, and if you would like to have the link to join us as well, please hit me up on the Facebook and you'll be able to join the panel discussions. Brother Sharif Bey, if you want to leave us with any closing words, you know what, the mic is yours, and we're going to be signing off.
I would love, real quick, I would love to be a part of the behind-the-scenes combo. Unfortunately, I have to go to the office and be back in my family. But I'm at your disposal, brother. I love what you're doing. I love the vibration and the spirit of your platform, brother. Ali's men is appreciative of the opportunity, and you will definitely all be hearing from us again very, very soon. We want nothing but the upliftment of fallen humanity, and our people are in most need of the upliftment. And that's what we sacrifice for them. So with that, I want to say peace, and I'll be talking to you all soon. Brother, again, thank you, brother, for the opportunity. This is amazing.
Definitely, definitely. Peace, Islam, and a shout out to all my Moors again. We're signing off right now. This has been Talk with the Titans, and I've been your host, Callum L., signing out. Peace.